Lionhearts, we're back in Los Angeles, and I thought, you know, today, let's go do a cemetery vlog. And I was thinking, who would be interesting to talk about today? And then I thought, well, there's somebody that pops out in my mind right away. A guy who wrote a book called I Am Not Spock. He also wrote a book called I Am Spock. Put out some records. He was actually born to Ukrainian immigrants with a very fascinating story. Eventually taught acting, and then became widely known as a level-headed, logical character from the planet Vulcan on the USS Enterprise. He brought us the Vulcan death grip, the Vulcan neck pinch. Today, we're going to go visit the grave, the final resting place of the great Leonard Nimoy. Daze with Jordan the Lion begins now.
Good morning, Jaw! Look at you, laying there in our bed like a king. Like a king! Now he's gonna bite his tail. Are you ready for a good day? Are you ready for a fun vlog today? Alright, Daze with Jordan the Lion and that man begin now.
So we're gonna be driving about 40 minutes from Hollywood to Hillside Memorial Cemetery, which is also where my pal Shelly Winters is buried.
Well, we've made it to Culver City.
Now, Hillside Cemetery is a Jewish cemetery, and this is the memorial to Al Jolson. Many famous people are buried here. Milton Berle, Jerry Weintraub, Shelley Winters, Mo Howard. Of course, Al Jolson, and the man we're here to see today, Leonard Nimoy.
Well, we found the section.
Now, I personally have never been to this section of the cemetery. I always just come and visit Shelley, so this is a new viewing for me. What a beautiful section. Take a look at this. What a great place to spend eternity. From some of the photos online, it looks like his remains are over here, at least his memorial is. One of these stones. Oh, that's really interesting. I just found Jerry Weintraub. You can see his says Weintraub Presents. God, that guy did a lot. He was had his hands all over the film and music business. I think I remember him from when I was a kid having the Karate Kid movie poster in my apartment. Well, in my apartment when I was a kid. We lived in an apartment. And I remember seeing his name on that. And right over here we have Leonard Nimoy. You can see it's even got the Spock hands on there. Now, Leonard Nimoy is a really fascinating guy because his family started in the Ukraine almost inadvertently. His mother and father both separately escaped the Ukraine in 1918 and found their way to the United States. And they ended up finding each other. They actually knew each other in the Ukraine, but then found each other again in Boston when they moved here, got married and started a family, and Leonard was their second son. And Leonard had a pretty great family. They were pretty supportive, and his father was a barber and his mother was a homemaker. And Leonard always strived to be the best at whatever he did, even if he wasn't terribly great at it. They said even when he was growing up in school, he wasn't the best student because he really liked to be out of school, hanging out, learning about life. And they said when every other kid was playing sports, Leonard was like the worst at sports, so he would become like the team manager until he found acting. He got into a play, got bit by the acting bug, and just loved it, and decided that that's what he wanted to do for the rest of his life. And when he told his parents, they were very surprised, but supportive. He ended up going to Boston College for a short time and then decided it was time to make the big jump. In 1950, he ended up moving to Hollywood. Now, this was not immediate success. Oh, look at that. It says, "Miss you, Dad." It was not an immediate success. He originally went to the Pasadena Playhouse where people like William Holden had studied. And he was really excited because he said, you know, when I first got there, I couldn't believe that I was around a bunch of people who all they cared about was acting. And this seemed like a heaven to him, even if he had to work side jobs to make it work. He had to work as a soda jerk or work in pet stores or whatever job he could find at the time. He said he was quickly dismayed by that experience because he realized that a lot of the people that were there studying at the Pasadena Playhouse at that time were ex-GIs that really didn't know what they wanted to do, and they just thought they could get by on their looks being an actor. So he didn't really get that much out of it and decided to leave the school and go off and try and make it on his own by auditioning for parts. Now obviously that's what anyone would do. Anyone that comes out to Hollywood wants to make it as big and as quick as possible. But he found that very difficult because he was getting little parts here and there for the next 3-4 years. Would participate in local play groups here. Like he actually was taught Yiddish when he was a kid. His parents never taught him Russian because he said that they liked to have that between those two so that they could talk privately, but they taught him and his brother Yiddish. So when he came out here, he had joined a Yiddish playhouse, which is where he met his wife, and would get little bit parts here and there, but like he said, nothing really significant, never anything more than 2 weeks worth of work. And then in 1954, he realized that he was going to be drafted, so he went ahead and enlisted and served his 18 months with his wife and his newly formed family, because he had had a daughter by that point. And when he came out, he was still dead set on becoming an actor, came back out to Hollywood and had a little bit more success, because this time he realized that he started to admire people like Marlon Brando and Montgomery Clift and realized that they were method actors. And so what he set out to do was find a teacher here, which he did, that taught the Stanislavski method acting style. And he said once he started doing that, once he engulfed himself in that technique, he started getting a lot more roles and a lot more significant parts where he could show his sincerity in acting, which is what he thought made him so successful. He said he thought that the fact that when he played a part, he sincerely believed he was that part, that that would eventually lead him to many different roles, one being on a TV show called The Lieutenant, which was a Gene Roddenberry project, and Gene Roddenberry would be the man that would eventually change Leonard Nimoy's life. You see, Gene had an idea for a new science fiction show that he wanted to do called Star Trek, and he decided that he really liked Leonard, and he wanted Leonard to be in this show is this character that he had created called Spock. And so he asked to meet with Leonard, and Leonard said, I was really surprised because when I went to meet with him, he was showing me around the set, because this was a pilot that had already been green lit, and he said he's showing me around the set and everything, and I'm kind of amazed because the way he's showing me the props and everything, it's almost like he's trying to sell me on doing this, when in reality, you know, like I said, I'd never been able to get more than 2 weeks worth of work, so I would have taken anything. Now Spock was really, really integral to this, because in Gene Roddenberry's mind, he wanted this to be a science fiction space show, but he wanted this crew on this USS Enterprise, he wanted it to be made up of not only humans, but also people from other planets, which is what Spock was. Spock was a Vulcan, so he was from another planet, but he was also partially human. And so when they went out to make this pilot, Captain James T. Kirk was not in the original pilot. There was no mention of him. There was another man named Jeffrey Hunter, I believe his name was, who was Captain Christopher Pike. And they made this original pilot in 1964, and the network didn't really like it. They thought, for one thing, they didn't really think that it had what they thought it was gonna have, the appeal. They didn't like that Roddenberry had originally written a woman as second in command. They felt that no one would believe that. No one in those times would buy that a woman could command a ship. And so, and they didn't particularly like Spock. They thought that he was, you know, maybe somewhat devilish, and that the Bible Belt, which was a big portion of their ratings, just wouldn't like it. And so they decided not to green light it. And Gene Roddenberry kind of reworked the script, came up with some new actors, and basically everyone that had been in the pilot was now gone, except for Leonard Nimoy, who was Spock. And I guess the reason that they didn't go with the other captain, Jeffrey, was because he was unavailable for the time that they were filming the pilot. So they ended up going with the man that we would know for still kicking today as James T. Kirk. He would make himself the star of the show. But when they filmed the pilot, here's what ended up happening. They filmed the actual show got green lit for a whole series. And when they first made the announcement to get advertisers, Leonard Nimoy said he had somehow got on an NBC mailing list because now he was part of the show. And he said when they mailed out the mailer kind of advertising what was going to be the new shows coming up, he said that they had changed the look of Spock. Even though they had taken photos, they had straightened out his eyebrows and they had gotten rid of the points on his ears. And he called Gene, he said, "What's going on, Gene?" And Gene said, "Well, you know, same deal. They feel that maybe Spock is a little too devilish, or that he's gonna scare people, turn people away from the show, and they're kind of veering away from that." But Gene held to his guns and said, no, Spock is integral. I need people every single time that they see Spock come on the screen to remember that this is a mixed group on this Enterprise. This is not just humans. These are not just Americans. It's not the United States Enterprise. So he said it didn't need to be Americans. So he fought for Spock to be in there. And what Leonard Nimoy said was, he said originally when it aired, the show was not a success, which was a little scary because he said this at the time was the most expensive pilot that had ever been shot, and they had shot it right there at Desilu. Now Leonard Nimoy said the reason that the pilot wasn't a success is because the pilot was not the true episode one. They decided to go with episode six of the first season as the pilot, thinking that it was the most sci-fi of all the episodes, and that would be what roped people in. But as Leonard said, he said that was actually the worst episode of the whole season, and we were all terrified as to what was going to happen. But he said as the other episodes came out, people gave it a chance, and then they really fell in love with it. And not only did they fall in love with the show, but they fell in love with Leonard Nimoy as Spock. Spock was getting so much mail that they said that Captain Kirk was getting jealous, because they were saying they wanted more Spock. He was level-headed, he was the logical one, and people just gravitated towards this guy who, you know, eventually would, like I said at the beginning of the video, would create this Vulcan death grip and this Vulcan neck pinch, and he said that really was his idea. Leonard said back in those days, you know, they weren't all that creative sometimes, and he said they were having in episodes where literally to beat somebody, they would just hit him over the head, and he said, "I just thought, you know, this doesn't make sense for someone as advanced as this culture should be in the 22,000s. So he said that, or the year 2200s or 2300s. He said, "So I went to Gene and said, I think, you know, this guy, you know, Spock should have gone to the Vulcan Institute of Technology. He should have studied the body and should be able to do one thing that just incapacitates someone." And so when they had that episode where there were two Captain Kirks, that's what he ended up doing, and it really caught on. Star Trek debuted in 1966, and it only lasted three seasons, 66, 67, and 68, and then they decided to cancel it. And Leonard said, "I was really happy that they did that, because really," he said, "we had new management, we had new writers, and the show was really suffering. The episodes weren't what they should be, and they weren't as good as they could be. So I was okay." He said, "I was ready to move on and do something else." So they ended up basically canceling it. And he said, "I went on to do multiple seasons of Mission Impossible, so I was financially stable." He said, "But then a weird thing happened where all of a sudden, now that Star Trek was off the air, it caught new wind in syndication and people were going crazy over it." He said they started having conventions, and then when the media came to cover the conventions, they saw people dressed up and with pointed ears and costumes and, you know, green makeup. And he said, "Of course, when you're in the media and you see that, you're going to gravitate towards that. So you run over and you film those people." They put it on the news and it became even more of a phenomenon. So he said for 11 years, we were all kind of trapped in this Star Trek world when there was no show or anything going on, until Star Wars came about. That's right, Leonard said that when Star Wars came out, everyone got a whole new reinvigoration for the love of sci-fi. People started talking about Star Trek again, and the next thing you knew, they were talking about making a movie 11 years later, after this show had went off the air. And as we know, Leonard Nimoy would go on to play Spock for 50 years, because they would go on to have multiple Next Generation and Deep Space Nine and all those, as well as movies in between all of that, and they're still making Star Trek movies. And Leonard Nimoy was so much more than Spock. He was so much more than an actor. In that time where Star Trek was off the air for those 11 years, where nobody was even, you know, considering it coming back on or anything, he had went off and he was on Broadway. He was directing plays. He was directing different things. He had a love for photography. When he was a kid, he used to develop photos in his bathroom as a darkroom. So he became a widely sought after and beloved photographer. He ended up making a record about Bilbo Baggins, had a hit song about Bilbo Baggins, and wrote books. He just really was a fascinating guy and led a very fascinating life. And even later on in his life, his son became a director, and together they made a movie about Leonard Nimoy's Boston. You know, what he appreciated about the Boston area. So here lies Leonard Nimoy, the man that taught us to live long and prosper and to go where no man has gone before. He now rests here, this beautiful section of Hillside Cemetery. You can see it says, beloved husband, father, Poppy, great-grandfather, and friend. Then if you take a look back behind all of these, somebody put like a little treasure chest. Sir Leonard Nimoy said that even though he and William Shatner didn't always get along, he does consider him, or did consider him, a lifelong friend and a great friend. And that a lot of that really came from the fact that William Shatner was hired to be the star of the show, and they didn't ever really expect Spock to be as popular as he was. And then when they started getting all that fan mail for Spock, said it just probably grabbed William Shatner a little bit the wrong way, but he said overall he considered him a great friend, and they were lifelong friends. In February of 2014, Leonard Nimoy was diagnosed with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and he attributed it to all of those years of smoking. And he spent the last year of his life in and out of hospitals before 2015, eventually going into the hospital for chest pains, where he fell into a coma and eventually passed away from the COPD diagnosis. Rest in peace, Leonard Nimoy. And thank you for your service. And that's gonna do it for us here at Hillside Memorial Cemetery today. Now let's go over to Paramount and see where they used to film Star Trek. There's Kobe memorabilia there. Right on top of that building, you can see the old RKO Globe, which was also Desilu. You can see the movie wagons out here, side of Paramount. And there's one of the Paramount walkway entrances. So right over here, you can see Stage 29. And there's a big blue whale on the outside of the building. That's where they used to film Star Trek. And if you look at the street sign right there, on the lot, it's Leonard Nimoy Way. You can see that the big blue whale building is Dr. Phil and the Doctor's studio. And check out the cool new mural outside of the Judge Judy studios. Be yourself. Well, my friends, I think that's gonna do it for us today. I hope you enjoyed this vlog. If you pine for my Hollywood vlogs, I hope this made you happy. We'll see you all next time. Thank you, Deborah Moeller, Angela White, Robert Landis, Tip and Tanner, Mark Sukup, and Chris Barlow for becoming Patreons. And thank you all for watching. Have a great one. We'll see you all next time. Goodbye.